Hello. Warm welcome to our today's session. In this online video, let us discuss about various system models for distributed and cloud computing. The topics covered under system models for distributed and cloud computing are clusters. What are clusters and why we are using clusters, and what is meant by grid computing, and how grid computing infrastructure will be using nowadays, as P2P networks stands for peer-to-peer networks, and these architectures we will discuss in this class. More lastly, cloud computing over the internet. These four topics we will discuss in this today online session. Let us move to the video lecture. The topic is software models for distributed and cloud computing. Now let us discuss about clusters of cooperative computers. What is cluster? Why clusters are required? How clusters are really required in our day-to-day life with the help of cloud computing? How it differs? We'll discuss in this session now. Here, why clusters are required? For discussing about why clusters are required, first let we discuss what are the drawbacks or limitations of parallel computing. In parallel computing, what we will do is, when we are using parallel computing is, suppose consider a big problem or large scale problem. The problem is divided into some number of problems, and each problem, sub-problem, is assigned for a particular CPU, and the CPU will solve the task parallelly. So the division carried here and the execution will be carried simultaneously by using multiple CPUs at the same time. They are using with multiprocessors shared memory. So in this way the parallel computers are working. So in parallel computing there is a drawback, that is the CPUs are running with the parallel computing is running with many CPUs, due to which power consuming is very high, and debugging is also one of the drawback for placing the services of parallel computing. So to overcome the problems or drawbacks of parallel computing, the best solution is cloud cluster computing. So here noted down some drawbacks of parallel computing. So some of the problems with the traditional parallel computing are expensive softwares. Why? Because we are maintaining or installing the softwares individual CPUs. It is very cost efficiency, and the maintenance cost also very high. Why? Because the main problem or the huge problem is divided into some sub problems, and to maintain these sub problems, separate CPUs we need to maintain from our end. So we need to provide the maintenance for maintenance team. We need to provide to monitor the servers and the monitor the CPUs individually. So it is also one of the time consuming and cost consuming process. And also we need to upgrade the softwares whenever a new software enters into the market. This is also costly, and very high initial setup is required. We need to establish a parallel computing setup at our home premises. It is very expensive. So to overcome the problem, instead of using parallel computing, we suggested that go for utilizing the services of cluster computing. What is cluster computing? How it will be benefited we will discuss in this video now. So cluster is nothing but the definition of a cluster is a cluster means a collection of a group of servers. A group of servers or a collection of servers which are interconnected to a network by using LAN or by using WAN is known as clustering or cluster computing. Let us consider a simple example here. A cluster computing is nothing but number of clusters. Here, different fish, the shape of the fish is considered as a cluster, cluster 1, cluster 2, cluster 3, and cluster 4. Assume that these four different clusters are considered as a servers. Here, we are combining individual servers into a single server. A big fish will appear as a cluster with multiple individual fishes. That is nothing but here if you consider a single fish image is considered as a cluster, as a server, a group of individual servers are combined together to form a cluster. So that is called as a clustering computing or cluster computing. Here in the right side, we have seen the image or the architecture of a cluster, cluster machine. In that cluster machine, group of individual servers are kept or interconnected together. That's why we can, they're providing the services in a group form. That's why we can consider this is a clustering. So why we use cluster is to replace the parallel supercomputers. Cluster computing is one of the best solution for us nowadays. So that's why we go for clustering. Now we will see what is the definition of a cluster, and with an example we will discuss in the next slide. So let us move to another slide. The cluster computing here, if you observe the architecture of the cluster computing, here what is cluster is nothing but clustering is a collection of or a group of multiple servers which are combined together to achieve the same service is known as cluster. In the diagram, if you observe that there are n number of clusters, namely S0. S0 is server 0, S1 is server 1, S2 is considered as a server 2, and up to n number of servers, Sn. Here a group of servers which are grouped together is called a cluster. So here a group of servers which are combined together is called as a cluster. Here a cluster of servers which are interconnected by a high bandwidth through a LAN, local area network, or through SAN, storage area network, or through NAS networks. That means that a cluster which is interconnected to the high bandwidth through LAN, WAN, or SAN. And these are interconnected together and to perform the shared resources of input devices and output devices and a bulk disk array process also here we can done with the help of the clusters. Sometimes the cluster acts as a simple single computer. Here the oval shape diagram is considered as a single cluster. The single cluster is act as a computer and that can be communicated to the internet. How a single cluster is communicated to the internet, that can be done by using VPN, that is called as a virtual private network. The cluster is well connected to the internet by using virtual private network gateway, that is called as a VPN. So here when the cluster is connected to the internet, here one single or unique IP address locates to the cluster. So in this way, we can set up a cluster computing over the internet. That's why we can consider cluster computing is also one of the best computing in the cloud computing techniques. So why we use cluster is there are many drawbacks the utilization of parallel computing. To overcome the drawbacks in the parallel computing, the best solution is you use implementing cluster computing over the network. So this is the example of architecture of a clustering or cluster computer. So next, move to another slide. Grid computing. We already discussed about cluster computing. Next, we move to grid computing. Grid computing infrastructure. So grid computing is also a subset of distributed computing. Grid computing is considered as a, it is a subset of distributed computing. What is distributed computing? We have seen the architecture and the development of distributed computing in earlier videos, my videos, we observed that distributed computing is nothing but sharing the resources over the network by distributing the work into different hosts. That is called as a distributed network. Here, distributed network, the systems are well connected to the internet. They are maintaining individual memory and individual hardwares, and they are interconnected together. So that's why we can consider this one as a distributed computing. The main advantage of distributed computing is nothing but when the computers are well connected with the help of the distributed computing, if any computer is failed or if any computer is having troubleshooting, the entire process may not be stopped. The process will be succeeded and we can achieve the task. So to overcome the problem, the best solution is grid computing. Grid computing is a subset of distributed computing. What is grid? Now we will discuss. Grid computing is a technique in which the ideal systems in the network and their wasted CPU cycles can be efficiently used by unit pools of servers, storage, and networks into a single large virtual systems for resource sharing dynamically at a time. So this is the definition of grid computing. Let us consider a simple example. Suppose, take an example of a centralized system. Suppose, let us take an example. Particular organization is maintaining a distributed system and a centralized system. In distributed system, many client systems are which are interconnected to the servers. Here we are using client server architecture. In centralized system, centralized computing depends on client server architecture. One single server and many client systems are interconnected to the server. So if we want to perform a task, client systems will take the initiation of the part and they are processing that. If the client machine is not working or there is a problem with the client machine, so finally the entire process will be stopped. Whenever we are working large scale projects with the help of centralized computing technique, if one computer is not working properly, the entire process will be disturbed. So that's why to overcome the problem, we moved from client centralized computing to the distributed systems. In distributed systems, what we are doing is many servers, many client systems. The big problem is to be divided into sub-problems, and the sub-problems are we are assigned to different tasks. So here, let us consider here an example. Consider a LAN. LAN means local area network. In that local area network, there are 20 systems, 20 client systems which are interconnected to the LAN. So among those 20 computers, Only 10 computers are idle. Idle is nothing but they are not having any workload, any traffic. They are not working now. And 5 systems are using less amount of CPU and their CPU cycles are wasted. So that means that, let us consider an example. 20 computers which are interconnected to the LAN, among 20, 10 computers are idle and 5 computers are working with less CPU amount. That means that here the budget is for 5 computers only. Remaining 10 computers are not having any workload. They are not having any traffic. So here we need to balance the workload for all 20 computers. We need to balance the work to all 20 computers. So instead of utilizing the CPU cycle for all 20 computers, the best solution is grid computing. Grid computing. Let us take a real-time example. Consider a banking sector. In that banking sector, SBI, consider that SBI is a banking sector. They are maintaining servers in different locations. During the bank working hours, the servers in metropolitan cities or in middle range cities are working with a huge traffic. The servers in remote areas are working with less traffic, and some of the servers in very remote areas, they are working with idle. So when the traffic is very high, if the traffic on the particular server exceeded the limit, the server will automatically shut down. So in this case, the processing is failure. When the server is shut down, we cannot process the operations, banking operations. In this case, the servers in some cities is working with a huge workload. The servers in some remote areas is sitting idle. To overcome the problem, the best solution is grid computing. When we apply grid computing among those servers, all the servers are interconnected together and they are working on grid computing network. In this case, if the traffic or huge traffic on a particular server is not a budget. Why? Because whenever the server is running with huge traffic, the server will divert the extra traffic to the idle servers which are available in remote locations. So the traffic what we received from different places, that can be shared for all servers, and all the servers came into the picture and they are running with small amount of workload. So due to which the burden or heavy pressure on a particular server will be reduced. All idle servers also came into the picture and they are working more. So this is the best solution for grid computing. Grid computing infrastructure. So earlier, before grid computing, how we can access a computer remotely, we will discuss now. What is a remote computer? A remote computer is nothing but a particular system or a client system access remotely by using one command that is called as a telnet. Telnet is the command which can act as a remote computer with the help of local area network. Sometimes we use HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Sometimes we need to transfer our files locally through WAPS or through LANs. In this way, we need to maintain a web service. Web service will be using one protocol that is called as a Hypertext Transfer Protocol, which enables remote access of remote web pages. Here, grid computing will allow close interaction among applications running on distant computers simultaneously. Grid computing is a processor architecture that combines computer resources from various domains, here remember the domains, to reach the main objective. When we are working on grid computing, computers are well connected to each other as they are sharing the network with different domains. That means that different domains is nothing but different organizations are maintaining their own domains, and these organizations will share the memory, share the resources over the internet with the help of the grid computing thing. Grid computing, we are used the infrastructure in grid computing. Infrastructure is nothing but what infrastructure is really required for maintaining a for a grid computing. Here is software. Software is a service. SaaS. Software is a service. We need to maintain a software or middleware. Middleware is nothing but a group of software services is considered as a middleware. A group of software services is considered as a middleware. And the sensors, IoT sensors, so these are offering by this type of infrastructure is offering by the grid computing. Whenever we want to rent it, a software as a services or a sensors are working with middleware, we simply go for renting a grid computing infrastructure. When our computer is well connected to the grid network, that means that we are working on LAN, local area network, or WAN, wide area network. Local area network means a limited area we will cover here. Wide area network is nothing but a organization or a city will cover here, or regional, national, or global. That means that this grid computing technique is well familiar with regional level, national level, or global level. Networking can be well connected if we utilizing the services of grid computing. Grid computing infrastructure can be utilized at national level, international level, and regional level with the help of LAN, WAN, local area network, and wide area network. And in grid computing, a computer used in grid, which are workstations, servers, clusters, and supercomputers. The infrastructure means here we need to maintain. The cloud providers maintain workstations, and they maintain bulk servers, they maintain clusters and supercomputers as an infrastructure for a grid computing. When grid computing infrastructure is well connected to the users, the user may access the grid computer infrastructure or services through personal computers, laptops, and through PDAs, and these are input devices. We can connect our input devices through these input devices. We can connect the network through internet to the cloud computing. We may access grid services through the internet by utilizing the resources of personal computers, laptops, and PDAs. We observe the grid computing architecture, two ways we can observe here. One is client side, another one is server side. If we see the architecture of the grid computing at the server end, it seems to be like a network, a grid of a network. When we observe the client end, it seems to be a wired or wireless network. Now let us move to another slide. My question is, where exactly grid computing is used? what are various applications we are using grid computing. Some of the well related applications for where exactly grid computing used are, the first one is telecommunication organizations. Example is BSNL. It is one of the government operated telecommunication network, and the ACT broadband network and Airtel broadband networks. These are well familiar broadband networks, and they need to operate their operations through cloud by using the help of grid computing. Grid computing will provide an infrastructure for these organizations, nowadays telecommunication organizations. And various government offices also nowadays, they are utilizing the services of grid computing. And multinational companies, national or international companies like IT industries, many IT industries like Amazon and Google, these are also well familiar with grid computing, and they are taking the services from the grid computing. Next one is financial organizations like banking sectors. SBI is one of the familiar banking sector in India, State Bank of India. That is, well, the network, if you observe in SBI, the SBI is well connected to the grid computing network. They are fully utilizing the services of grid computing over the internet by rented the services to the cloud, from the cloud. Let's move on next slide. What are various advantages of grid computing? Grid computing can solve complex problems in short time. Why? Because in centralized computing technique, if you want to solve the problem, complex problem, it takes more amount to solve the problem. To work the problem, we introduced parallel computing and introduced grid computing. In parallel computing and grid computing, the problem is divided into, complex problem is divided into small number of subproblems, and each subproblem is assigned to a particular system or CPU. So that's why the complex problem is to be divided into small problems, and the small problem is assigned to a particular CPU. The CPU will execute the task simultaneously, so due to which within the short time period, the larger problem is to be solved very easily. So one of the best advantages of grid computing is large problems can be solved very quickly. And second one is very important point, no computer be idle in this system. Idle means without any traffic. A computer working with without any traffic load is called as idle. That means that sometimes some servers working with the huge traffic, sometimes some servers sitting idle. This is not the correct scenario in our day-to-day life. Why? Because if we follow the same scenario, whenever huge number of customers try to access a single server at a time, the burden on a particular server will be very high. If the same may continue, the server may shut down, due to which the processes are stopped. Meanwhile, to overcome the problem, the best solution is grid computing. When the computers or servers are working with grid computing techniques or networking, using load balancing technique, the traffic will be distributed equally for all servers. In this case, every server is having a little bit workload. Every server should be working with same or equal traffic. None of the server in the grid computing network will be sick idle. So this is one of the best advantages of grid computing technique. This can be done with the help of load balancing only. Another best example is another advantage of grid computing is unit works makes all computer like a supercomputer. And another important advantage is make better use of hardware. When all the computers are having work traffic, if none of the computer will sit idle, that means that we are the grid is better utilizing the hardware components. These are advantages of grid computing. Let us discuss the architecture of grid in this session, in this slide. Consider the diagram here. If you consider the yellow color dotted block over here, there is lot of equipments, lot of processors, databases which are interconnected together. Grid includes this yellow color part is considered as a single grid. What grid will include? A grid can include workstations. Workstations is nothing but the collection of servers is considered as a workstations. Workstations, large number of servers and a mesh of processors and Linux clusters to satisfy a chain of computational needs. Here, equipments like servers, processors, and Linux clusters and databases, these all are considered as a grid. All these grids are built across various IP broadband network, including LANs and WANs. These grid components or grids are well connected to the broadband network through LAN, local area network, or WAN, wide area network. Here, the communication among the grid to the internet with the help of various shared resources. Here, various shared resources is a camera, a telephone, or a mobile phone, or a TV, a computer, a laptop, and a digital book, and another biometric fingerprint machine. These are well-defined, well-known resources. All these resources are connected to the internet through the grid network only to access the data to perform the task. This is called as a grid computing architecture. So finally, we can conclude that grid computing is considered as a, it is just like a cloud computing. By using grid computing, we can perform or we can complete or we can be able to do tasks very easily, very quickly, whenever we are working with large scale companies. So this is the architecture of grid. Next, we move to the comparison of grid computing with cloud computing. So in terms of various criteria here, over here, on the left side, and these criteria will be depends how it is differ with cloud level and how these criteria will differ with cloud level, we will discuss now. The first one is user management. Consider in grid computing, the grid computing is always working with client-server technology. The architecture of grid computing working with client-server architecture. There are many clients. All clients are interconnected to a single server, that is called as a client-server architecture. That is nothing but decentralized management. So decentralized management is nothing but not a single server. There are many servers, there are many client systems. Decentralized mode, the grid computing is working. The grid computing is not working in a centralized mode. The cloud computing is working with a centralized mode only. Why? Because the cloud vendor will maintaining a bulk of the servers over the internet. Any person or any end users want to access the resources over the internet, their client systems are directly or remotely connected to the network with the help of the internet, and they may access the resources of the cloud through the internet. So here the cloud computing is working with the principle of centralized management. That is called a client server architecture is the best example for client computing, and decentralization is the example for grid computing. Next one is dependency criteria. How the dependency will vary in terms of grid computing and cloud computing, let us see. In grid computing, computers pick up the work whenever the computer stops. Whereas in cloud computing, totally dependent on internet. That means that if many computers are internally connected together to a server, different servers, if any one of the client server machine stops or troubleshoot that this is working with a problem, the entire network may not be stopped. The work or the traffic over that client server machine will divert to the another client server machine. The process will continue and the processing and the task or the thread will execute the task successfully. So that means that no interruption at all. So this is the best one for utilizing the services of grid computing. Next one is operations. Operates within a corporate network. So grid computing we can establish in a corporate network, whereas the cloud computing will establish over the network. Globally we can access that, but here we can access LAN or WAN in grid computing. And grid computing can be accessible through middleware grids only. A collection of softwares here we are using. So here client server architecture is not suitable for grid computing. We can use middleware architecture for performing the or for accessing the resources of grid computing. Client, server, and meanwhile one more third party is allowed to perform the task. That is called as a middleware. And in cloud computing, the accessibility through standard protocol HTTP or some other protocol, we can access the resources over the internet. And grid computing is working with multiple domains. And whereas the cloud computing is working with a single domain only. Why grid computing is working with multiple domains is to execute the task in a short period of time. So this is connected to with different domains. Domains is nothing but ahit.ac.in is a domain. jnu.ac.in is another domain. Some other .gov is another domain. So working with different domains here. Scalability is normal here. Here the scalability is very high. That means that why the scalability is normal means when we the computers are working with grid computing network, the traffic over the computers are distributed equal. So that's why it is normal. But whenever we are working with cloud computing technique, the network of the computers not sharing equally the traffic. Some of the computers are having huge traffic. Some of the networks are working with a less traffic. So that's why the cloud computing scalability is very high. And next one is grid computing is also follow the architecture of distributed computing. And the cloud computing follow the architecture of client server architecture. Next one is virtualization. Virtualization means here data and computing resources will act as a virtualization In cloud computing, here the hardware components and software platforms will be acted as a virtualization. We will discuss about virtualization in second unit later. And the computation, split computing perform very high computation, and cloud computing will be computing based on the customer requirements as a demand. If the customer demands, we can use the services. If there is no demand, sit idle. So that is on-demand services, always working with the principle of cloud computing techniques. And application type is the grid computing. Here each computer is considered as a grid that performs batch wise. Here in cloud computing, interactive wise. So finally, various criteria we already compared with grid computing and the cloud computing technique. Let us move to another slide. So as of now, we discussed about what is grid computing and what is clustering and what is cluster computing. Next, we move to another service model in cloud computing, that is peer-to-peer network. Simply, we can call as a P2P. What is P2P? P stands for peer, another P stands for peer. Here, a peer is considered as an autonomous computer. A single computer is considered as a peer. These computers are interconnected through a network and they are sharing the message, sharing the information locally with the help of the router or ethernet is considered as a peer-to-peer network. In a peer-to-peer network, the peers are computer systems which are connected to each other with the help of the internet only. If you consider the diagram here there are four different computers, two laptops and one desktop system, another one also a server or desktop systems. These each device will be considered as a peer. And these peers are connected in a dual mode to the ethernet or to the router. Here there are various switches. There are 1, 2, 3, 4 and four switches. These four switches are outmost switches and this is internal switch and next one is power adapter. And the first computer is connected here and the second computer will be connected here. That means that the first computer, desktop computer, sharing the message or sharing directly the message, transferring the message from one computer to another computer through an intermediate node that is considered as a ethernet or a router. So in peer-to-peer network, the files can be shared directly. Here files is nothing but data in our personal computer. We keep the data whenever we want to share the data directly between the systems on any network. We use peer-to-peer networks without the need of a central server. If we want to share the information or files from one system to another system over a network, in this case, we need not require any central server. Simply, we can share the information from one computer to another computer by connecting the computers over peer-to-peer network and they can share the network easily. Next one is, in other words, each computer on peer-to-peer network becomes a file server as well as a client. So, very important point here. In peer-to-peer networks, there are servers or there are clients. We may consider as a server this one. We may consider this as a client system also. We cannot specifically say that a computer only connected or a desktop system only connected or a laptop system is connected. We can connect to the, we can connect a computer system or personal computer, or we can connect a client system, or we can connect a server also. So peer-to-peer network becomes a server or a client. The same system may be acted as a server, the same system may acted as a client system. here. Why? Because here we are not maintaining any central server. That's why our local computer system can be acted as a client. Our local computer system can be acted as a servers. When you create an ad hoc network between two computers, you create a peer-to-peer network between them. Very important point here. Whenever we want to set up a wireless network or ad hoc network between peer-to-peer networks, at that time, this is the best example. The best example for peer-to-peer network is Skype. As we all are aware of that, Skype is one of the premier app. We can communicate or we can conduct the meeting or online chat, online video. We can perform with the help of the Skype. It can provide a temporary or ad hoc network between two computers with the help of the peer-to-peer network. Best example for peer-to-peer network is Skype and Ripple. These are well familiar devices. Next, move to another slide. What are various key advantages of peer-to-peer networks? As we have seen, peer is nothing but a computer. Best advantages of computers peer-to-peer network over here is easy file sharing. If we want to transfer the file with the help of HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol, over the same network. So peer-to-peer network is very useful and they can transparently transfer the data from one computer to another computer quickly over the network with the help of the peer-to-peer network. Second one is low cost, reduced cost. Why low cost? It is nothing but when the organization is working on peer-to-peer network, when the computers are interconnected to an organization with the help of peer-to-peer network, we cannot maintain a server. Why? Because here each computer will be acted as a client machine and each computer will be acted as a server machine. So no need to maintain a server. If we want to maintain a server on premises, we need to establish a room, we need to establish a software, and we need to establish use space for that, and for bulk servers also we need to maintain. So to overcome the problem, the simple solution is peer-to-peer network. When peer-to-peer network will be established in an organization, there is no need to invest a separate computer for server maintenance to set up a peer-to-peer network. Next one is adaptability. Adaptability is nothing but whenever if you want to add a new client to the peer-to-peer network, it can be performed very easily. Peer-to-peer networks extends to include new client easily. So already set up is existing. If a new client want to interconnect to the existing peer-to-peer network, it can be done very easily. So that's why we can focus on this one. Adaptability is also one of the important factors. Let us move to another one. How cloud computing perform a vital role over the network? So cloud and internet, these two are well familiar words. What is internet and what is cloud? We have been discussed in first class, basics of cloud computing. With there is no internet, no cloud also. Cloud is an architecture. The architecture of the internet will be formed in terms of a cloud. That's why we can name it as a cloud. So how cloud computing will play an important role over the internet, we will discuss here. Consider the diagram, the architecture of a cloud here. The cloud can include internet clouds and it can provide some services, some networks over here, and softwares also, hardwares also, and storage devices also. All are embedded into the cloud over the internet. And The cloud will providing the services to the end users by paying the amount paid services. Sometimes they may provide free services also. Whenever the end user submit a request to the cloud, an end user want to utilize the resources in terms of infrastructure as a service, in terms of software as a service, in terms of platform as a services. When an end user want to utilizing the services of the cloud over the internet, they can simply go for rented. The cloud providers will offering the services to the end users by paying the money as a paid services. As we have seen, we have discussed in earlier class, infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, software as a service are well familiar cloud service providers, service models. Infrastructure is nothing but we need not maintain any infrastructure in our local premises on house. The infrastructure what we really require that can be maintained by the cloud provider only. The cloud provider will maintain servers. The cloud provider will maintain storage, various networks and data centers. Simply our duty is simply connected to the cloud remotely, and we can access the infrastructure as a service through the internet by paying the rental amount to the cloud provider. Here we need not maintain any physical servers, any physical networks, any physical data centers. So that's why always prefer go for utilizing the services of cloud instead of setting up your own premises. Next, another one is platform as a service. Consider an example. You have an app. A person developed an app. To access the app, if you want to access the app, he need a platform. He need a deployment tool. He or she need a software. But in on-premises, we want to deploy the platform as a service, we need to spend lot of money for that. Why? Because we need to pay lakhs or crores of money for Java or web services or some other softwares. To overcome the problem, simply we can take the services, platform services from the cloud vendor. If the cloud vendor will provide all the services, middleware, databases, and deployment tools on some other Java or some other softwares, they are provided for us by paying the rental amount to them. Next one is software as a service. Software as a service, some of the business models, some of the industries or HR, they are completely depends on software and they are effectively utilize the services of the cloud providers, what they are really providing software as a services by paying the money on a rental basis. So that's why, so one of the best advantages of cloud computing over the net internet is always the end users can utilizing the services offering by the cloud by paying the amount on rental basis. Next, cloud computing over the internet. We have discussed some service models in last slide. Next, move to here deployment models. There are four different well-defined cloud deployment models, namely private cloud, public cloud, hybrid cloud, and community cloud. This is the new one. In earlier class, I have not discussed about community cloud. Now I discuss about community cloud. So finally, sometimes I may consider only three, but the new one also included now, that is called as a community cloud. So once your setup is ready, you want to host your setup over the cloud, You can utilize the services of the cloud. If you want to deploy your model into the cloud, you have three options. One is public mode, private mode, or hybrid mode, or community mode. What is public cloud? Public cloud is a cloud which can be offer the services over the internet with free of cost to all end users. That is called as a private public cloud. Suppose Google is a cloud service provider. The Google is providing one service that is called as a Gmail service and Google App Engine. Google App Engine is also providing free services as a public cloud, and we can search whatever we require in Google Classroom. In Google App Engine, with the help of Google App Engine, we can type something, the Google will retrieve the required data from the server or cloud with the free of cost. Everybody is having rights to retrieve or to access the data through Google App Engine and Gmail also. Gmail is one of the application which can be provide free services through public cloud, through network, through cloud. So Gmail is one of the example for public cloud. Everybody is having Gmail with free of cost, and they may access the services from the cloud with free of cost. Next one is private cloud. Private cloud means there are some limitations. Only restricted members can maintain the cloud services based on their specifications and based on their configurations. They need to set up their own cloud configuration over the cloud over the period of time. That is called as a private cloud. Private cloud can be maintained by a person, or private cloud can be maintained by a end user, or private cloud can be maintained by an organization. So private cloud is not having access to all. So best example is IBM, or best example is SBI. SBI, State Bank of India, is maintaining their own private cloud. Only the customers is having an account with SBI, they can having the access to access the SBI server remotely. They can access the services provided by the cloud service providers whenever, wherever they require. So that is called as a private cloud. Sometimes we need to access, we need to the retrieve from the cloud. So the utilization as publicly sometimes go for privately. So that means that a combination of both private and public cloud is called as a hybrid cloud. Hybrid cloud will be acted as a private cloud and public cloud. That's why hybrid cloud is also one of the familiar cloud nowadays. But it is very costly. Why? Because here you are utilizing both private clouds and public clouds remotely. And another familiar cloud is community cloud deployment model. Community cloud is nothing but the cloud services shares among various organizations and companies which belongs to same community. This can manage either by third party or internally. That is called as a community cloud. Community cloud, when we go for utilizing or deploying the models into a community cloud, whenever we are working with the same community, then only we can go for cloud computing, community cloud. So community is nothing but business community or telephony community or healthcare community. So all healthcare sectors, they are utilizing form a community, healthcare community, and they can retrieve the data, they can post the data over the community clouds. Some of the well familiar benefits of community cloud is improved services, very secure and very reliable, scalability and flexibility. These are various benefits if you compare other than community cloud. Thank you, students. So finally, I can conclude this session. In this session, System models for distributed computing, we have been discussed in this session various system models. The first one is clustering computing. What is clustering? Why exactly cluster is needed? So cluster is needed because of drawbacks are limited, to overcome the limitations of or the drawbacks of parallel computing, we introduced a new computing that is called as a cluster computing. And architecture of the cluster computing and the various applications of cluster computing also we discussed in this session. Next, what is grid computing? How the grid computing architecture or the infrastructure will work, and what are various advantages grid architecture also discussed in this session. And next, peer-to-peer network. What is peer-to-peer network? Why it is using peer-to-peer network? How peer-to-peer network will be effectively used in cloud computing also we discussed in this session. And next one is, what are various cloud service models, cloud deployment models over the internet, we discussed in this session. So now I am closing the session. Thank you one and all.